Awesome. A lot has changed since the last time we were on a recording session. For starters, I've got a haircut. My hair is no longer tied in a bun. I think that's very refreshing. And I see that you're also a lot more energetic because we already know what we want to talk about today. We have so many topics on our agenda. We're
Yeah.
going to delve into a little more detail. But what's changed since the last time we spoke on your end?
Indian matchmaking. I mean,
Indian
I feel like
matchmaker.
that's been what's changed for everybody, right? But significantly for me, because thanks to the show, I feel like there's been a lot of attention on the kind of work that I do. And now a lot of my relatives actually think that I keep flying all over the world to set people up and I make millions.
Well,
So the upside is people recognize what I do as a legit profession and don't think that this is social work or a hobby, which is cool. But also I think there's been a lot of conversation just about marriage and the marriage market and what people
yeah.
go through being in it. So truly.
As of 2 weeks ago, if you Googled matchmaking on Google, you wouldn't be overwhelmed with the content. But cut to today, I think you will be a little blown over by the kind of content that's thrown at you. And this is just an effort to talk about some of the things that both of us are very passionate about. And tell us about that news article that came out recently, where I'm going to let you talk about it. I'm visibly excited.
Because of the show, obviously, Times of India wanted to do a feature on new age matchmakers, and so they interviewed me to find out how I matchmake and how similar or different I am from Seema Taparia. They also just wanted to find out my views on the whole show itself. Obviously, I've written about it. It's up on my newsletter, shapelygal.substack.com. Probably leave a link to it below at like later when we publish this video. So that's what the article was about. And obviously, it's now opened up a Pandora box of opportunities for me that I'm just overwhelmed and grateful to be dealing with.
That's super cool. And I remember the day you shared that, and I was like, that's so cool. Because there's finally one article in the newspapers about a cool matchmaker. Now, I've known you for some time now, and I can for sure say that you add a cool quotient in the whole ancient process of Indian matchmaking, so to say.
Thank you, thank you. You've
Yeah.
also
And
been
we
subject to it live through Dinner Club, which is cool, right?
For sure, yeah. I tried our dinner club, and I think a lot of people reached out to me that saying that they also wanted to take a shot at it, but then dinner club came to an end, as we all know.
Yeah, we
A
closed
lot
the
of people
applications, but
about it.
hopefully we'll do it again.
Was that a reveal? Was that a secret reveal for season?
I don't know.
Are you trying
I'm
to not give away something that you already know?
in the
What
business
is
of
going on?
selling hope, so I shall obviously indulge in such cheap tricks.
So for the folks who are listening, don't be disheartened because there is a very possible season two out there. And if enough of you actually go ahead and sign a petition. Maybe that will force.
So actually, you can register an interest now on the Dinner Club website saying, hey, whenever you do the next edition, I'm interested. So that's still open for you to let me know that I should think
Okay.
about you next time this happens.
There'll be another link in the description below where you can find a link to register.
Super.
Yes. Going back to Indian matchmaking,
So
I'll let
I,
you go here.
yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, so obviously Indian matchmaking was so interesting. People had a lot to say about every single person on the show. I kept thinking, is there anything that you and I always talk about that could sort of be really useful for people who are looking to date? And was there any interesting message that came out of the show itself that we can actually positively take away? And one of the things that I thought about was all of these characters went on dates with people, right? Some dates seemed really nice, and some dates were a little bit awkward. So I actually wanted to do this episode with you to get your thoughts on what you thought, people could have done better on their date in terms of just communication, right? Like, could they have communicated with each other in a different manner? to influence the outcome of the date. I wanted to actually analyze that with you with a few characters to see if there's anything useful that people can take away listening to this.
For sure. I think these characters are very well established now and the viewers will directly relate to them. And off the bat, I just want to say that a date isn't an entirely different game. It's just your regular mode of communication, but I don't know why it's been painted in such a, you know, freaky and spooky way. It's just this, it's just the same thing.
And yeah, but it's like a job interview, right? Like, it's scary.
I think a job interview would be scarier because, yeah, I mean, you have to pretend like you know stuff at a job interview. Here, you're just being yourself. And that's something that I've seen people struggle with, which is being themselves. And as cliche as it sounds, that is the secret to a very successful date, which is being yourself on it. Not pretending like you're somebody else, not pretending like you know something that you already don't.
It's so just, do you think anyone did that on Indian Matchmaking? Do you feel like anyone was struggling to be themselves?
It physically hurt to watch some of the dates because there was absolutely no communication. The communication channel absolutely broke down. There was no conversation happening. And yeah, there were awkward silences, awkward pauses, which are never great for any conversation.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you about the one that I really liked. And we can base the conversation off of this one person.
Sure.
I think I absolutely fell in love with Vyasar.
Okay.
So Vyasar not just was a very happy person and a teddy bear like figure whom everyone loved on the show. His style of communication was so spot on. Everything was done so gracefully, so right, and people don't realize how simple it is to keep it simple.
Yeah, why? Like, it's interesting, right? Like, obviously, they painted Vyasar as having like a really sort of difficult childhood, having experienced so many things. For me, it was amazing to see someone who's gone through a difficult childhood to still not be guarded or you know, come across as being right amount of vulnerable on his dates. Like, I found that very interesting. What's your take on that? Like, how do people like leave their baggage and then come to a date and still have a good time?
He does have a very obvious advantage that's working for him, which is his career in public education. His career involves him talking to a bunch of kids and a bunch of strangers every single day and breaking the ice. So breaking the ice is something that he learns on the job every single day. So that is an unfair advantage that he has over the rest of the people. But even his communication style with families, with the girl's family or his own family, right? In the previous episode, we spoke about how if you're good at public speaking, it needn't be a fact that you're good at communication in general.
Sure,
but
sure.
We saw Vyasar being great at both of those things. We saw him absolutely breaking down the ice between his students and at the same time being so conversative and communicative with the girl's family, which is great. And I think he could do this because, like you said, right, he had so much baggage and he had a lot of background emotions and stress to deal with. And he himself admitted on the show that he hadn't completely processed all of them, but I personally feel like he had to a great extent.
Sure. Did you notice any difference in the way he communicated between his two dates? Like, the two different women, two different personalities is quite obvious. Rashi seemed like someone who was funny and much more sort of friendly and less guarded in some sense. Did you notice any difference in the quality of the date?
So you would assume that it's an obvious thing that your communication style would change from person to person. But with Vyasar, it didn't change at all.
Mm-hmm.
Vyasar was the exact same person with Manisha that he was with Rashi. He made the exact same lame jokes. He said the exact same things to diffuse a tense situation that he did with Manisha as he did with Rashi. And that's the secret key. Consistency. Knowing what your style of communication is.
Right. That's awesome, right? Do you feel like anybody else through the show had a consistent style, like among the other characters or like among the other people?
So two characters that I absolutely loved, one was Vyasar for sure, and the other one was Nadia. And I think the entire internet is going gaga over Nadia on the show and how genuine she was. And it helps that she's also very pretty. And in all of her dates, right, she was so lively and bubbly. And it didn't matter if it was an introvert sitting opposite her like a guru or an extrovert like a Vinay. She was the same.
So
people we loved so far, Vyasar and Nadia, both of them have one thing in common, which is both of them were the same on all of their dates.
Yeah. It's interesting, right? Like some people had this argument where they said, you know, Aparna is the way she is or behaves the way she is because she could just be jaded. She could have just gone out on so many dates that she's just jaded right now. But at least through the show itself, seeing, let's say, Vyasar and Nadia go on multiple dates, we didn't notice a change in the way they were with different people, right? Like, why do you think they were resistant to being jaded or, like, weren't susceptible to being jaded as much as the others?
So, for one,
any thoughts on that?
For starters, I vibed with Aparna on an entirely different level.
Okay, what is that?
I completely get the fact that dates can be a huge waste of time if you don't connect with the person.
Sure.
I completely get that if you're not having a good time, it's not necessary to sit there in a restaurant for 3.5 hours. And I know a lot of people who've been there. I know people who are watching this have also been there or are going to be there when the lockdown ends. So, I mean, her concerns are very legitimate. As much as you may hate her character or hate her attitude on the show, she was being herself. And those were legitimate concerns. She was one of the very few people on the show who was supremely comfortable with who she was. She didn't care.
Right.
Like when Shekhar didn't want to go on a second date with Aparna, you would assume that that would leave her a little, you know, sour tasted with a bad aftertaste.
Sure.
But that didn't happen at all. And we thought that, oh, maybe she's trying to hide it. Maybe it'll reflect a little later on in the show. But that didn't happen either. She just moved on unfazed because she was supremely comfortable with who she was as a person.
Right.
I mean, she knew her limitations. She knew the things that were going for her. And when you understand everything that's going for and against you, it just becomes that much more clearer to expect things from the other person.
Right. So there's this one bit where, you know, people have been outraging a lot about where I think one of the guys says, you know, I'd go be on a beach for 10 days. And she says, why do you want to go be on a beach for 10 days? That's just so weird. Although she explains it later on saying, hey, my life is so great on its own that I find it weird that, you know, someone has to go to a beach and chill for 10 days. How bad should their life be? But then when she reacts to it, then and there saying, hey, that's weird. How does it come across to the other person? I mean, of course, we have all our judgments looking at it from the outside. But if you were in that guy's place, like, how do you look at it?
So I think we're reading into it especially a little too much because it is Aparna who said it.
Sure.
If it was somebody like a Nadia or somebody like a Vyasar would have said it in a slightly sarcastic tone, we wouldn't have batted an eyelid.
Mm-hmm.
But because you know, because Aparna's character has been established on this show as somebody who's a hustler, who's a go-getter, who's very ambitious, who expects the same in the other person, you're reading too much into it saying, oh man, this woman's crazy. But maybe, like, there was an underlying clarification to it, like she said, where she didn't.
But it's also interesting that the other guy, the one who she says this to, there's a little clipping of him where he comes in the same episode where he says, oh, thank God, it's over, right? he had a very strong reaction to the day.
Right.
I understand that the show has been made in such a way that they want to paint a certain picture of Aparna to the audience, and that's why it's been made this way. And you don't really know the context. You might be missing some context there, right? But let's just pretend like that's all there is to it and there is nothing else. In that situation, do you think, you know, you could be who you are, but is there any different way in which you could communicate to make the other person feel comfortable versus, oh my God, thank God the date is over kind of feeling.
Yeah, it did feel like a factoid, didn't it? When she said that, why would you add relax in front of that word? It felt like it was a sort of knee-jerk reaction. It felt like she was making a statement. It didn't feel like a playful thing to say. So maybe if you said it a little playfully, maybe you're like, why would you want to relax? Come on. Are you serious? Yeah. That would have sort of diffused the situation right then and there. And maybe the other guy wouldn't have felt the, you know, in the face reaction.
Yeah.
But it did feel that way because, and again, that's Aparna's style of communication, which.
Yeah. So that's my question, right? Like if you see her talking to her friends, she speaks in a very similar manner, right? You get to know Aparna a little bit while she's talking to her friends and say, hey, that's how she speaks even with her friends, not just with dates, right? But if you're meeting her for the first time or you're looking at her for the first time, like you or me, you don't really know that about her. You don't know enough about her and you make all your judgment just based on one date, right? So would you in such a situation say that she needs to change her style of communication or be who she is and hope for the best?
I'd go for the latter, always.
Okay.
Be who she is and hope for the best. Because recently, I was interacting with a colleague of mine whom I know really well. And I know his style of communication. I know what the things he says and how he says them. But not everyone receives the things he says the same way. And after the communication where I'm like completely sweating about the things he said, I'm like, dude, how could you say such things?
Yeah.
And he just says, dude, you know what? I know I'm an ass. I know there's nothing I can do about it. You just got to deal with it. I think that's so endearing.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
And he's a single. He's found someone who's just like him. So you hear what I'm saying? So just because your style of communication is off-putting to some people,
yeah,
doesn't mean you're gonna die alone.
Okay, that's great to know because you know obviously I'm not an expert in communication or how my communication is perceived. So I felt like I needed some validation from your end because so my husband's got a blog on which he writes all sorts of things. There was this phase in his life where he would write really sort of absurd stuff about the whole marriage process or about, just the whole thing. And his friends would always tell him, with a blog like that, you're never getting married. Like, no one will want to marry you because of the stuff you write. And interestingly, I fell in love with the way he writes on his blog about these topics. And so I guess it helped that he was being himself and, you know, found somebody who appreciated him for who he was, right? So. But, you know, great to get some validation from a communications coach like you.
For sure. And like your husband not only married someone he loved, he married someone who's a matchmaker. So, I mean, look at what happened, right?
Yeah.
So, I go back to what Phoebe said in Friends. He's your lobster or she's your lobster. You're going to eventually end up with the person who's your lobster.
Right.
I know this is... This sounds a bit fairy tale-ish right now, but I firmly think that you shouldn't change your style of communication for somebody else.
Sure.
You can communicate more effectively.
Okay.
You can find your way of communicating, but you can't change what you inherently are.
Got it. That's interesting. So do you think any of the people on the show could have communicated more effectively in terms of who they were and you feel like they missed an opportunity to really just be themselves on any of the dates?
Pradyuman, Akshay, both these people especially stand out because they talk fine.
Yeah.
They know English. They're fine with their friends. But every time it came to a date, it was like there were breaks put on their side of communication.
Right. Why do you think that happened?
Because maybe, okay, so there is obviously cameras on you, so that could be a little intimidating. That's one. And the second thing is you suddenly become conscious of who you are as a person. You suddenly become conscious of whether or not you're funny, whether or not you're using the right grammar, whether or not the stuff you're saying makes sense, whether or not impressing the other person, a lot of factors, right? So whenever you're conscious, whenever you're put under the spotlight, we generally don't like being, humans don't like being put under the spotlight.
Correct.
People who are good under the spotlight have just learned to navigate their way through the difficulties. But usually people don't like being put under the spotlight because it makes you feel like you're separated from the pack. And as humans, we love belonging to a pack.
Got it.
You're suddenly being separated and you're put out there and somebody's expecting something from you. So you'll obviously break a sweat.
Sure. So at this point of time, do you have any tip for people who struggle with being under the spotlight and not know how to communicate effectively? Like, for example, you have a date coming up. Are there any exercises or anything that you would sort of recommend that people do so that they feel more comfortable to communicate effectively?
This seemed like a no-brainer, yet so seldom used. Do more of what scares you. Okay? Just put yourself in situations that would scare you, that would frighten you. And, you know, fighter pilots don't have simulation exercises for no reason. Go out with a friend of yours and do like a training date.
Okay.
Go, you know, simulate the entire environment of you getting the check, of you pouring, some wine into a glass, of you making small talk. Try it all out. You can't expect to go and score a century on your first match, right?
Got it.
So, we used to do this a lot back in, at least in school, where if you had to go propose to the girl whom you had a crush on, we would practice it with our best friends.
Would that be a boy or a girl, though?
It would preferably with someone of the opposite sex because the emotions come more naturally, and you're close to real life as possible because you're actually talking to someone from the opposite sex.
Got it. Let's say you have no access to people from the opposite sex, which is also why you need help because you've never done this before and you're freaked out about it. Mm-hmm. What would you recommend they actually talk about on a first date? And how do they prepare themselves to go sit there, be themselves and also feel comfortable? Do you have any sort of hacks on the top of your mind that you can share?
So this is, I don't know how about dates, but this is what I do with stepping on stage, right? You're supposed to anticipate everything that can happen before you go up on stage. Mm-hmm. You're supposed to have a Google Map sort of a vision of what can go wrong, what can go right before you step on stage.
Got it.
But once you step on stage and the game has begun and you're performing, whether it's on a date or whether it's on stage, once you grab the mic, there's no point anticipating because you've got to be there in the moment. So many people, instead of observing the tiny little things happening on the date, the tiny little things that are being said, instead of being observant, they're thinking about what to say next or about that joke that they thought of 10 days ago or thinking about, hey, this face looks familiar. Maybe we have a mutual friend. Let me quickly take out Facebook and stalk this person, right? When this person in front of me, right? So stop multi-processing when the situation is live. Multi-process before it as much as you want.
Yeah.
Anticipate what you want. But when the is live, when the entire situation is real, experience what's real, be observant, see the tiny things around that's making this experience come true.
Got it. So on Indian matchmaking, where do you think the dates were two-sided? Like good from both sides. Where do you think they were, you know, just one-sided, and where do you think both of them sucked?
Again, with Vyasar and Rashi, right? Rashi wasn't very outgoing right off the start. I mean, even though she did go to help Vyasar in the kitchen to make the green tea and everything, she was a little apprehensive of what to say, what not to say. And Vyasa just immediately broke the ice. He was great at building momentum. And once he built the momentum and, you know, took them onto the runway, then they were in a parlay of sorts where they were both like playing tennis back and forth. And now I'm not talking about them playing table tennis. I'm just talking about the tennis, which is conversation.
Sure.
Right? So it was both of them complimenting each other. The same with, Vyasar and Manisha. And it's the same with, even though I'm not a fan of Vinay's style of speaking, even Vinay and Nadia, they were great at communicating because Vinay instantly said, you know what, I just converted to veganism. There's no particular reason. I mean, he just gave a fact out about his personal life. He made himself vulnerable out there. And that encouraged Nadia to be vulnerable. One person took the initiative and then it rubbed off on the other person and then boom, you were both having a great time.
That's interesting. Why did you say you're not a fan of Vinay's style of communication?
I just felt like he was using too many words where he could have used fewer words. Not efficient. It's not frugal conversation. If you finish it in 3-4 words, why say 10?
Sure. That's why I guess there were times when he went completely missing.
Yeah, I mean, he finished up his word limit and he didn't have anything more to offer. Because every sentence had 3 likes. I'm not a fan of that style of conversation. There were too many fillers, too many, I'm saying you know a lot. That's also a filler.
Yeah, I was going to say I'm guilty of that too. Where do you think the conversations were terrible from both sides?
Oh, okay. Akshay, on all of his conversations, even conversations with Seema auntie or with his mother sometimes.
Sure.
I mean, she's a mom, dude. Communicate with her.
Sure.
Don't just laugh and stop midway. Okay. I mean, you're on camera. It's fine if that's your natural sort of communication, but you're sort of employed for a show. So put up a better show, right?
Sure.
So Akshay with Radhika, I think her name was.
Yeah, Radhika. Yeah. That was a terrible conversation.
I can excuse him for the first date, okay? Both of them are sort of new to each other and they don't know anything about the other person.
Yeah.
So it can be interesting.
Yeah.
There was a 10-second pause and he said, "So, what's up?" I mean, that's no way to build a conversation.
There was also this other conversation where, you know, he calls her from somewhere, he's traveling or something.
Oh, yeah. What are you doing? I've been talking to you.
That was the worst. I mean,
I know. I mean, when I was watching the show, I was like, kuch sikhao isko, kuch sikhane ke liye.
What kind of suggestions do you have where a date turns out like that? Where, let's just assume there are 2 introverts or 2 people who haven't had any sort of exposure to this and they meet on a date. Do you have any sort of tips or anything to rescue them?
Address the elephant in the room. Address the fact that both of you are doing this for the first time and you're both nervous. And when you have something in common, you'll bond over it.
Sure.
Right? With every date that Vyasar went on or with every date that Nadia went on, they addressed the fact that, hey, so why matchmaking?
Yeah.
I mean, I've been doing it for some time.
Yeah.
And then they suddenly had a topic to talk about. But Akshay and Radhika had nothing to talk about. They were talking about cats and dogs on their first date. are you kidding me?
True. So there was a date between Pradyuman and Snehal and they met for lunch. And I thought the date was kind of, they weren't saying much. It wasn't like a deep, engaging conversation or anything. It seemed very small talkish.
Yeah. I mean, with Pradyuman, I think both his dates were very similar. Pradyuman's an outgoing guy. He interacts he's very amicable, gets along with his friends. He's very outgoing by nature. I don't know why he struggled with his conversations, both with Roshali and with Snehal. He didn't have much to offer. He didn't have much to say. And the conversation seemed very, very superficial. I don't know why that happened. If you're going to watch.
Here's my take on it. And I could be completely wrong, but like my reading of the situation was, I think with Roshali, he was probably nervous. He felt like she was in some sense too good for him, which is why he kind of agreed to see her in the first place, because she looked good. Because he says, what do you do apart from being glamorous or something like that, right?
I mean, that's never a good thing to anyone. Never say that.
I mean, I felt like he was nervous, which is why he didn't do well in the conversation. But with Snehal, I felt like he went in wanting to make conversation, but I think somewhere she didn't keep up with it. She didn't encourage him to continue speaking because, I don't know, it became so weird. Like he was like...
You're right. I mean, he instantly saw Snehal and he went, oh, townie girl.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly.
You could see that chip on his shoulder throughout the date. And right after the date, he said the word simple and innocent, which indirectly translates into, oh, she's not as modern as me.
Yeah.
Not my type.
Yeah.
And Tanmay Bhatt and Rohan Joshi said it very right on their reaction to the episode, the Indian matchmaking, where he's like, Pradyuman wanted a babe, basically. Right? He could have just ended his requirements there. He just wanted a model chahiye.
Yeah. I mean, that's so true, right? Like, I was telling this to somebody on a podcast earlier today, where I was like, the problem with most men is they're too shy to admit that they're superficial. So that's why you will send them 100 profiles before they probably admit to you if you hold them at gunpoint saying, listen, I have not found anyone pretty enough. Mm-hmm. When he keeps talking about that attraction needs to be there, that attraction needs to be there.
And mental attraction. And
I don't know if it was attraction or erection, but anyway, I think...
One of those things.
Yeah. Maybe. So... Yeah, so I felt like...
You know what got me on a second date? I paused the video and I took a good 10 minutes to recuperate from that laugh. He said, what sort of animals? Mammals or sea life? And I was like, dude!
Oh, I completely missed that. Where did he say that?
So they were talking about mutual interest in animals. And she said, I love animals.
Okay.
They said, oh, what kind? Mammals or sea life?
Okay. I completely missed that. I felt like I kind of switched off the moment he said that line about, like, what do you do apart from being glamorous? I was like, this date is gone.
Yeah. I cracked even narrating that story. So I knew we were going to be doing this conversation, which is why I observed the details in those dates very minutely.
Got it.
And I can get past this one.
So how do you think the whole horse riding situation helped? Do you think
that was very interesting? I think that was very interesting. In fact, my favorite concept of a date was Srinivas and Aparna's first date, where they went axe throwing. And the way he said, this is not antagonistic, but at the same time, that brings a competitive spirit to it. You have stuff to do. You're not sitting with your hands folded there and waiting for the other person to say something clever. You're doing something. You're looking silly. You're becoming vulnerable. The whole competitive spirit makes you vulnerable.
That's
you're going to drop your hesitations and throw that axe as hard as you can.
Yeah.
And it's also a fair point that don't give Aparna an axe. She's probably going to kill you. But
like when Srinivas was sitting with... the rest of our family trying to make an attempt to have conversation, etc. She really appreciated the guy, right? She kept saying nice things about him to the point where he said, I didn't make enough money, or like I lived with my parents or something to that effect, right? Like you could immediately see her face dropping, this guy is not my type kind of reaction. I want to take on both, right? On should Srinivas have said that on a first date? Mm-hmm. And second, was there a different way for Aparna to have dealt with that situation? Communication-wise.
Okay. To begin with, I just want to say that I'm a huge fan of Srinivas's on the show. I think it was the typical silver fox. Mm-hmm. He had the nice white grays on the sides. And I really liked him. I thought he was a proper gent. And the way he conducted himself, the way he carried himself throughout, even with the cameras on him, the slight double takes that he was giving was very
cool. Natural. And like,
I maybe saw a bit of myself, a bit of my mannerisms in him.
Interesting.
And I think that's what made it more relatable for me. Okay. And his communication was bang on. And I don't think it was a wrong thing to say that to admit that he wasn't making enough money until recently. I think that's good.
But the question is on the first date.
That's absolutely fine.
Because that is being a little bit too vulnerable, right?
You're wasting lesser time. If you said it on the second date also, I don't think Aparna would have been okay with that.
Yeah.
Because Aparna had her priorities very clear that she wanted somebody who's just as ambitious as she was, and that wasn't Srinivas, and it wouldn't have been Srinivas even on the seventh date.
Yeah.
Even if they met 7 times.
Yeah.
So I think Srinivas saved them 6 dates, and I think when Srinivas said that I didn't start making enough money until recently, I don't think it was a way of saying, hey, I'm not unsuccessful. I think what he was actually saying there, what he was trying to say there was, this is who I am and I'm in love with my life. I love everything that I do.
Yeah.
I'm completely okay with everything that I am.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like a secret to him.
Yeah.
To him, it was just the way he lived life.
So that's interesting that you say that, right? Like, because I feel like a lot of people are generally comfortable with their partners being that way. However, mm-hmm. you're not comfortable before they become your partner.
I didn't get what you... Could you...
Like, meaning, this is, again, something that was discussed on an earlier podcast today where we were talking about, like, are women comfortable with men who don't mm-hmm. make as much money or who don't have a successful enough career, etc.? The whole discussion was around, you grow to be comfortable with it if that is the case of your partner, like after you're with them. However, I don't think most women are comfortable when men say that to them pre-relationship. So do you think that's something that people should kind of ease it in after a couple of dates, or you still think, or see, is there a different way in which he could have said it?
Depends on how you view it. See, if I was Srinivas and I'm completely embracing the fact that I'm just letting go of my qualms and embracing life, and that is who I really am. That is so me. That is the emotion that is running in every nerve and sinew in my body. I'm not going to be embarrassed about it, even if the girl's going to splash her wine drink on my face and walk away. That's just very me. If I hide that fact, I mean, that's what I mean by being yourself. The first date should very clearly reflect who you are as a person. And that's just who Srinivas was as a person.
Interesting. So you're saying now, that if he had met somebody who could empathize with his situation, like... Mm-hmm. he would have done better, like someone who is similarly very happy with what they're doing. Like, for instance, Aparna said she hates being a lawyer, like despite wanting to be a lawyer from when she was 7 years old, she said she hates being a lawyer. So do you think if he had met somebody who loved what they did or the way their life was, just the way it was in his case, do you think the conversation would have carried on from there?
For sure. I definitely think that would have been the case. And there's one more thing. Now that I think about the words that I've just said, I definitely think there is one thing that Srinivas could have done better, which is brand himself better. For sure, he's now, following his passion of letting life take him wherever life wants. He has written 3 books.
Yeah.
He is an author of his own podcast show.
Sure.
That's not a tiny thing. It takes work, courage. And a thick skin to build.
Yeah.
And writing 3 books isn't a joke. You can't write 3 books in a year.
Sure.
So I think he didn't sell himself enough on those fronts. I think he could have done a better job at building it up.
How would he have sold himself better? And I ask this question particularly because there are a lot of people, especially now, who are in the midst of switching jobs, changing careers, etc., like, you know, even thanks to COVID in some sense, but they don't stop dating, right? Like, there's no reason to stop dating just because, you know, you're in the middle of a career change. How do they present themselves in terms of what's happening with their life without coming across as not being serious about their career?
I'll give you a simple example, a quote unquote, this word Srinivas said, I write books. Now, I write books could also be phrased as I'm an author. It's a very simple differentiation. What did you call me? You called me a communication coach. You didn't say that I'm somebody who does workshops. That's very vague. I'm not selling myself well enough. If you go look at my Instagram or Twitter bio, it's a very detailed description of all the things that I do in correct phraseology. It's not vague. I say that I'm public speaking and a communication coach as well as a presenter and show host. I don't say I do events. I love event management. That's being very vague. You're not.
Yeah.
So people love seeing. People love perceiving things that they can see and feel.
Yeah.
So I write books is not something people can see and feel. But I'm an author is something people can see and feel.
That's very interesting. Like, that's so subtle, right? Like,
Yeah.
I feel like people don't pay attention to that at all. Like, so I guess, you know, last couple of questions before we sort of wind up is there any, if there's any message that people who are single, who are dating, should take away from the show and from this conversation in terms of how to communicate on a first date and how to take things forward, what takeaways would you have for them?
Okay, I'll be guilty of summarizing my own points from throughout this episode, but I will repeat myself for effect.
Yeah.
First of all, as cliche as it sounds, be yourself, unapologetically yourself. If you're an ass, embrace it. If you're somebody who's just quit your well-paying job to go and, you know, go for some soul searching, embrace it. All of those things are very you. And that's the image that the other person wants to see. The second thing is that be observant. There are lots of tiny things happening while you're on the date. So there's no point thinking about a bunch of things that you had planned already. There's somebody dropping a cup and a saucer. There is somebody who's come with their poodle to the restaurant that you're in. There's a cute puppy that you just saw from your peripheral vision. There's lots of things happening. So be more present and be more observant. And like Aparna said in one of her dates, when I'm on a date, eyes here. I'm supposed to be the prize. Eyes on the prize, fella. So that's very important. So eyes on the prize, make the other person feel special. Always remind yourself that it's a two-way street. It's a constant reminder that should be buzzing in your head that it's one of your divine responsibilities when you're on a date to make the other person feel special. Like if you're, that's not a check mark at the end of the date, you failed.
Yeah.
It's one of your duties on the date to make this other person feel special. And what's the other thing? Yeah, if you're nervous, address the fact that you're nervous. Talk about the elephant in the room. That sort of tends to diffuse situations. Those are the common things.
That's awesome. I think they're like definitely very legit advice, right? Because I feel like these are so simple, yet people miss them. But it was really useful to sort of reiterate the points that you just made. So that's about the show and what we took away from the show. But just on a last note, sort of summarizing everything we spoke about and actually taking it a step further, if someone were to communicate about themselves, let's say on a dating bio, or just, you know, they're meeting somebody, you know, at a party, maybe not now, but like at some point, what's a good way to introduce yourself? So that the person learns about you, doesn't feel like you're bragging too much, yet is interested to find out more. How do you open up the conversation to include them?
It's funny because I recently did a workshop on personal branding, but that wasn't for somebody looking for a life partner or a possible relationship. So it becomes slightly tricky. There are two audiences commonly, one who likes to talk about themselves, who likes to sell themselves in a nice and packaged manner, and the other who doesn't want to talk about themselves and wants to play the modest card, play the humble card, make a joke or put a joke in their bio. I think a good bio is a combination of the two. You need to talk about what makes you you, whether it's your job, whether it's your family, whether it's your pet, whatever it is, where you're from, what is your inherent nature, all of those things that make you you. And the second thing would be to sort of diffuse the situation and make it look a little less serious, make it look more inviting and playful. With maybe a clever one-liner. I know that a pun is the lowest form of humor, but it goes a long way in my personal experience, whether it's you introducing yourself to a possible, future relationship partner or just anybody. And when you're trying to break the ice.
Got it.
And I know you're great at this, and this is something that you've been mastering over the years, which is writing a great bio and great introduction. And that was the case with Dinner Club also.
Yeah.
So maybe you can tell a little bit about what you were looking for.
Yeah. I actually have an anecdote or an example to share. And I think I had shared in one of the newsletters. I found a particular bio very, very interesting because the person spoke about himself. He gave like a line or two about who he is and what he's aspiring to be, but also immediately sort of toned it down by saying, I don't want to sort of end up this way, which is why I'm doing this, this, this. And also added a line about when you and I talk, we're going to talk about these things. So it helps people identify with him quite easily if they relate to the same things, right? So I've seen a lot of bios where people are like, oh, I've studied here, I've lived here, I work here, I was awarded this, I was awarded that. But they don't, those bios are not inviting. They don't seem like conversation starters. They seem like advertisements. I think it's interesting that you said the second part of it must be inviting to include somebody. So I was going to ask you, like, I know you don't do this or haven't done this, but is this something you can help people with, especially like introverts or people who haven't had a lot of opportunities to go on dates? Do you help them effectively communicate about themselves and also effectively conduct conversations with the other person? Not from a dating coach perspective, but just how do you communicate effectively with another person when it's one-to-one?
For sure. I think that's something that has been working for me for the past few years. I find it very easy to strike a conversation with anyone, even a wall for that matter. Even if I'm left alone in a party, I can sort of go and mingle with anyone from any side, whether it's my friend's side or whether it's from the invitee's side, doesn't matter. So yes, I can definitely help anybody who's looking for some help and give them some perspective and simulate a real life environment to maybe make it look a lot more real.
Got it. And how can people reach out to you? Like how can they reach you to set up some time to discuss this with you?
The best way to reach out to me would be either on Instagram, where my handle is @RahulKolle, RahulKolle, or reach out to me on my website, which is www.rahulkolle.com. In both of these places, you can get in touch with me and I'll be more than happy to help you out and we can set up some time.
Awesome.
Where it's a win-win for both of us. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Because I feel like a lot of people, do need help with this, but just don't know where to go. And, you know, there are lots of dating coaches, etc., that talk about, you know, observing the cues of the opposite gender. And it's all very from a gender perspective. And I don't mean it that way, but just how do you effectively strike up a conversation with another person in a one-to-one setting and do it on a personal level rather than a job interviewee sort of way?
There's an interesting way to put this, actually. I was reading one book, I don't remember which one. And in that, it was talking about how to effectively conduct workshops. Mm-hmm. Or it might have been a train-the-trainer course that I was taking. I don't know. Mm-hmm. In that, it said, the job of a trainer or the job of a workshop is to bring you as close to your natural self as possible. A trainer's only job is to remove the hurdles in your way from being yourself. You're not trying to make a cake. You're not building something from scratch.
Sure.
There are roadblocks that are making you, that are stopping you from being you. We just remove those roadblocks.
Yeah.
And it needs to be, any learning sort of a session needs to be as natural as possible. And when you have to try and understand an entirely different game like dating, it can be a little discouraging. So we won't be doing any of that if you were to converse with me. We'll just be talking about basic communication, things that both people find.
That's awesome. Yeah, I think I feel like I might have people to send your way. And, you know, obviously people will have the links below. Cool. This was really an awesome conversation. I feel like because of this, I made you watch the Indian Matchmaking. Personal win.
Something after a very, very, very long time. The last show that I watched was, I think, Money Heist. I hadn't binged anything for 2-3 months straight. And it was nice binging something again on Netflix.
And it was an easy watch. Not too long. It was, that's awesome. Those of you who are out there single, and if you're in a sort of, you know, marriageable age, I don't know what that is, but like if you're in the market to find yourself a partner, you can reach out to me on marriagebrokerauntie.com. That is marriagebrokerauntie BROKERAUNTIE.com. I feel like the name is really long. or you can reach me on Twitter or Instagram. Instagram, same handle, at Marriage Broker Auntie. Twitter is at Marriage Auntie. So reach out to me if you have any questions. And, you know, if you have any questions about communicating and being awesome on your dates, then Rahul's the man to reach out to. Thank you so much, Rahul, for helping us break down every date and analyze the communication styles, etc. This was really insightful, and I hope everybody out there learned a thing or two and can actually apply it in dates that are coming up. And if they aren't coming up, you know where to sign up, Dinner Club. Would have closed applications now, but, you know, still register your interest on Dinner Club and we'll send you on dates soon. Cool.
This is
awesome.
So much.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, likewise.